Hello.
You know, every now and then I come across some bit of Jewish history that blows my mind. And this is one of those chapters. It is the chapter of the so-called Nasi of Narbonne. And it refers to the historical legacy of a Jewish kingdom in medieval France. Now, it's been argued about for decades by historians, especially after the 1972 publication of Arthur Zuckerman's amazing thesis, which was published by Columbia University Press. It's hard to believe this story, but let me go through it and I'll tell you all about it and you can make up your own mind. So first of all, where is Narbonne anyways? Let's have a quick look here at this map. Here's where Narbonne is, right on the coast, basically, of the Mediterranean in the south of France, in a region known as Provence. Here's a closer look at it. And in fact, you can see from this map that on the left is an arrow pointed to Narbonne. On the right, there's an arrow for the Rhone River. That's where the kosher riverboat cruises are going to be exploring Jewish history this November, God willing. So this is still within the same region. To Jewish history, it's known as the home of the Chachmei Provincia, the sages of Provence, because there was a tremendous flourishing of Jewish scholarly and creative activity in this region in the medieval period, which may have a lot to do with the actual story of the Nasi of Narbonne. So in order to understand the context of this story, we have to go back a little bit. You can see from this map that the Visigoths controlled a significant portion of the Iberian Peninsula and extended themselves northward into Gaulish France, and they controlled this territory for many centuries. That changed, however, in the 8th century, as we shall see. But before that, we should note that there were Jews living in the Visigothic Empire right from the very beginnings. We actually have Jews in the Iberian Peninsula from the 1st century. There's some fascinating epigraphic evidence of Jews living there, gravestones and things like that. We basically did fairly well in Visigothic Spain. The Visigoths actually followed a much more tolerant form of Christianity called Arian Christianity. That's Arian with an I as opposed to with a Y. And it differed from the dominant forms of Christianity at the time, largely in their more human approach to the status of the founder of Christianity. This changed, however, significantly with the conversion of King Recared to Catholicism. Here's an amazing painting by de Grand that shows the conversion of Recared. Here you can zoom in. Look at his face there. Wow, he looks like really religiously motivated here. And unfortunately, with the conversion of Recared in the year 589, that meant that the Visigoths suddenly discovered anti-Semitism. And it was a way of kind of communicating their bona fides to the Catholic world at large by persecuting the Jews, unfortunately. And they instituted a 122-year reign of terror on the Jews with absolutely incredible, unusually intrusive persecutions that really you wouldn't see for hundreds of years except in the Iberian Peninsula. Things like, you know, Jews had to report in when they traveled, and there were all kinds of horrible punishments like amputations and scalpings and things like that. It was a horrible period of time for Jews. That ended in the year 711, which is of course celebrated by the local corner stores. No, just kidding. That was just my strange sense of humor. When the Muslims conquered the Iberian Peninsula from the south and actually penetrated with some degree of success into southern France, the region where we're speaking of. Coming in of the Muslims actually shifted the position of the Jews in a very positive way, because the Iberian Peninsula really involved a triangular culture. Christians, Jews, and Muslims had to coexist within this region, and Jews were able to exist in this kind of triangular relationship in many ways much more successfully than they could in the binary relationships they had with Christians alone as a tiny Jewish minority in a Christian-dominated Europe, or as a Muslim-dominated minority in North Africa and the Near East. But that's going to take us a little further afield from where we are. Narbonne was at least briefly enclosed within the new Spanish Empire. And that's which takes us to the story of Mahir, the first Nasi of Narbonne, as the story goes. Now, as you know, Narbonne is, of course, within France. Contemporary France, that term is anachronistic for the period we're talking about, and France is, of course, a Christian nation. That is extremely relevant for our situation because the Visigoths lost to the Muslims, and then the Muslims were able to take over some of that southern French territory. The French, the Franks, as it were, wanted to, and the Burgundians and other peoples wanted to reclaim that territory. And as a result, the Jewish influence was quite significant. Under Pepin le Bref, here's a picture of him. His name means Pepin the Short. He actually, according to the legend, made a deal with the Jews living in Narbonne that if they supported them against the Muslims, they would in return receive significant benefits, which is essentially pretty much the same kind of deal that the Muslims had with the Jews in the Iberian Peninsula. And this worked to the Jews' advantages. So as the story goes, the Jews established a self-government, a self-rule within French territory, I'm using that term anachronistically, that ultimately was led by a Nasi. So let's see, what exactly is the Nasi? The term Nasi is classic in origin. You see it particularly in the Mishnah. There are some extremely important figures called a Nasi. It's usually translated as prince. For example, Judah the prince, Yehuda HaNasi, who is the editor of the 3rd century amazing book of Jewish law called the Mishnah, which in turn forms the core of the Talmud. The Nasi was kind of like a quasi-political, quasi-religious role that even after the Romans had destroyed the temple in Jerusalem and removed the Jewish self-government there, they nevertheless allowed the Nasi to have some authority over the Jews living within Israeli territory, or that would be Roman territory at that time. Outside of Israel, you also had descendants of the same family. They're all tracing their lineage back to King David, who were recognized as the rulers of the Jewish community. In Babylon in particular, where this map is depicting, the Jews were ruled by a figure called in Aramaic, the Resh Galusa, which means the head of the exile. And in English, that's usually rendered as exilarch, right? The head of the exile. And this person was a descendant of King David and had authority sometimes in tandem, sometimes in cooperation, sometimes in conflict with the great Talmudic academies of Pumbedita and Sura. From time to time, the heads of the academies, the Rosh Yeshiva, and the exilarchs did not get along, and there were conflicts over, in particular, succession crises. Now, according to the story that we're dealing with, one Natronai ben Habibi was an exiled exilarch in the 8th century from the region. He made his way across the Mediterranean, and he found himself in Narbonne. There he took the name Machir ben Yehuda Zakkai, but the Jews of Narbonne, as the story goes, recognized him as being a bona fide exilarch, and if he was an exilarch in Babylon, he should also be an exilarch here in Narbonne. And that's the legend of how he came to be. Now, once just being called an exilarch by the Jewish population doesn't mean anything, but once Pepin the Short came in and said, listen, shore up our defenses against the Muslims who took over from the Visigoths, and Machir ben Yehuda, with his presumably natural leadership qualities, was able to insert himself into that that conflict between the French and the Spanish Muslims, then in fact that's how we have the exilarchate, or the Nasiut in Hebrew, in Narbonne. Now, this apparently lasted for some 400 years. Amazing. Why don't we know much more about it? The primary fact is because the vast majority of the sources that we have that refer to the Nasiut are quite late in nature. Two of the most significant are Benjamin of Tudela, who was a noted traveler of the 12th century. You can see this map here that shows his remarkable journey around the Mediterranean basin. We're not sure whether he actually traveled to all of these places or perhaps he just reported from some of these places, but he was one of these amazing medieval travelers who left behind an account of his travels, including his stay in Narbonne, which was very close to his actual origins in Tudela. Also of the 12th century, Abraham ibn Daud, who was a great historian who wrote the Seder HaKabbalah, which is not what it sounds, it's actually a historical book, and they both refer to the existence of an exilarchate in Narbonne. That's fantastic. The only problem is, it's like 500 years after the fact. And there are a lot of gaps between a couple of scattered references in the early period until we have these accounts 500 years later. And so most historians have totally dismissed the story as legendary, but nevertheless, it has some fascinating repercussions. You have to read Professor Zuckerman's book to really get the full story. So that's it for a very quick overview of this amazing little tidbit of Jewish history. It's not at all impossible that in fact there was a Jewish kingdom in France, but we will have to do more research to really understand properly. I hope that some of you will be able to do some of this research with me live as we explore Jewish history along the Rhone Valley this November. But that's about it for today. I hope you enjoyed this short video.